Okay, good afternoon. Today we will talk more about training neural networks. How to initialize them, pre-process data, start the weights, do training via optimization in a clearer way, and so on and so on. And you have watched two lectures of Stanford, CS231 and Convolutional Neural Networks course. Okay, and I just squeezed into a few slides and prepared something of my own. So, and the first point there, so your data, your images or whatever entering neural networks, and the first thing people do, somehow rescale and maybe a little bit convert the data to make training more easy. For example, if your original data is like cloud of points, so it's in two dimensional. Assume the neural network has two inputs, yes, x1 and x2, and usually people show a scatter plot, yes, for every data point, for every x in input, you show first coordinate versus second coordinate, the two points here, and quite often it's some cloud. If you would have Gaussian distribution, it's this way. Different. What people quite often do, they center the data and they also rescale it to have unit variance in every dimension. But also there is something more. You may also rotate your cloud, despite it's not always done. It's actually quite often people do not do this, but it enters us to the issue of principal component analysis. So I will use this excuse to remind you, because the issue of PCA is so general. Many of you may already know this. Please raise your hand who already know principal component analysis. Okay, so it's good to remind. It's good to remind. Maybe you will get another more clear view on this issue or alternative view on this issue. Let me see the slides which I've prepared. Okay. And everything. Ideal, yes.
Yep.
Assume that I have a cloud of my data which looks in this way, or maybe looks in this way. How can I distinguish between those cases? So the notion of covariance helps me. So covariance is expectation of product xi with xj. So covariance of x1 with x2 on this picture is zero if you have this flat oriented ellipsoid. And in this picture it's positive. So if I increase x1, I have a tendency that x2 will be also increased. And And here the covariance is negative. I reminded you, really very basic stuff. And so this is Cij. And Cii, of course, is expectation of product of x with itself. And if through my slides, I will consider x so-called centered with zero expectation. If the x is zero expectation, so expectation of its square is just variance of x. This is very, very basic stuff. And what people say they are interested in principal component analysis to find a direction.
What is exactly this symbol? It's the span of x1 multiplied by x2. I don't understand.
Ellipsoid.
No, the covariance, the definition. Cij is what?
Expectation of product x1 with x2.
What is the expectation? Can you say in Hebrew? Maybe a
tohelet. What is a tohelet?
Tohelet, and this is shel shnei evarim.
תוחלת של מכפלה x1 כפול x2.
x1.
If I have a random variable, I have a random two random variables, x1 and x2. X1 is a random variable. It is for example it has an expectation, but the most important thing we have all. The projector. So, I have a random variable x1, and I also assume that expectation of this random variable is zero.
X1 is just a number. What do you mean?
No, it's not number.
It's a function.
X1 is just a random variable.
Okay.
It's a random variable.
I
just switched notions. The only thing in probability you are used that the value of variable is denoted with small letter and the random variable with capital letter. But here, because I have matrices and vectors, so I don't have this freedom. So you should remember, x1 is random variable.
Oh, okay, so x1 and xi and x3 are not subtons.
It's a random variable, but also I have a little confusion in notation, but from context, sometimes I have some other index, the samples of x1 and x2, also with this the same letter.
Okay.
But in this context, these are two random variables. I and J is 1 or 2. Wow. It's really serious. Okay, I will talk more about screen and less whiteboard. Something happens within our building. Okay.
So the projector doesn't fade out.
Yeah.
I have a random variable. So its expectation is 0. And in this case, expectation of its square, x1 square, is sigma 1 squared, is variance of this. Okay? And the same I have about x2. But I have also expectation of the product, x1 multiplied by x2. And this is called covariance of two random variables, x1 and x2. Okay. This is what is here. Now, assume that I... every point that I have realizations of my samples of my random variable of x1 and x2. And so I just generate Magrib. Draw. Okay. My values of x1 and x2, and put a point here. And do it many times, so I get cloud of points.
Okay, אז בעצם אתה עושה את ההנחה שהדוגמאות לקוחות מאיזושהי התפלגות.
Yeah, yes, I assume that there is a joint distribution of x1 and x2. And each of them has its marginal distribution, if you like. So, and still we can have, an independent source of light. If I have this cloud of points, quite often this cloud is elongated. So, and I ask, what is the direction in which variance of my data is the strongest? In other words, what is the longest axis of this ellipsoid which I drew? And direction of I can put the unit vector in this direction. This will be direction of first principle component, and the value multiplied by this direction will be component itself. So I can decompose my vector x as random variable y1 multiplied by vector v1 plus random variable y2 multiplied by vector v2. And usually, let me put one slide down. Yes. And if I will scatter plot those values y1 and y2, I will discover that they are not correlated. Y1 and y2. So it's like I rotated my ellipsoid. I consider my ellipsoid in this axis. I forget about everything. This is my first coordinate, this is my second coordinate, and in y1 and y2 I have this kind of picture. And the question, how algebraically may I find these vectors v1 and v2 and corresponding y1 and y2. And for this, it's convenient for us to move to matrix notation. If I have a vector, in my case, vector with two coordinates, but x1 and x2, but it may be more, and put it as a column, and multiply by its transpose. I get a matrix with entries xi multiplied by xj. This is exactly what I want for correlation. So if I will take expectation of this matrix, I will get correlation matrix. I will get matrix that entries cij will be covariance matrix. Cij will be covariance between xi and xj, and on diagonal I will have expectation of xi this multiplied with xi variance of xi square variance of xi. Okay. There is a way, assume I have many samples of x, of vector x, and put them into columns of Lagrange matrix. I can substitute expectation approximately with sample average. What I will do, first column multiplied by its transpose plus second column multiplied by transpose of second column. Actually, I will need to multiply this data matrix by transpose of itself. So it's very convenient to do it. And of course, I need to divide by number of subs. You may discover divided by k 1 over k minus 1 statistics. Quite open. Okay, now what we can do with this? So I have this square matrix. By the way, this matrix is symmetric because
it's a Gaussian matrix.
Huh?
It's a Gaussian matrix. It's always symmetric.
Okay, it's symmetric. You may say because of this, because it's product of matrix by its transpose. But it's also symmetric because correlation of xi with xj is the same as xj with xi. So in any case, it's symmetric. I may do its eigenvalue decomposition. So if lambda is a diagonal matrix of eigenvalues, and V is a matrix which column it's orthogonal matrix for symmetric matrix. Orthogonal. The columns are eigenvectors and columns are orthogonal to each other. What we can do, we can multiply this expression from the left by V transpose. So V transpose V is and from the y right by v, v transpose v again is identity, and get this expression that v transpose multiplied by our covariance matrix by v is diagonal matrix. But if we remember that our covariance matrix has this expression x multiplied by x transpose. So I can substitute it here and get this expression. And here I can denote V transpose X as some new data Y. And I will get my transform data Y in this way that Y transpose is diagonal matrix. Exactly as in the picture we already saw. So what is my action in principal component analysis? I express my vector x as y1 multiplied by the vector of the largest variance plus y2 by vector of the smaller variance. If I have more dimension, I will have more of them. And y1 and y2 are non-correlated. What is written here, I can express that x is some matrix v with columns, vectors v1, v2, and so on, multiplied by y. So the first sample of x, it's the first V multiplied by the first sample of Y, so on. Because V is orthogonal, I can multiply from the left by V transpose and get again V transpose X equal Y. And you see here actually what we did, it's the same. So we come to conclusion is that if we do eigenvalue decomposition of matrix of covariance matrix, we get and of course we should sort eigenvalues. The first one should be the largest one, and then smaller and smaller and smaller. So we get a sequence of vectors of our principal components and why it's corresponding random variables characterize the behavior in each direction. Okay, so this is a way to show PCA. I don't know. It will accomplish what you already knew, or it may be I don't know. Okay.
I have a question. So,
yes.
In general, we can do the eigenvalue decomposition if matrix is diagonizable, right?
Yes.
So, what does it mean in terms of our case that the...
Good question. If my matrix is a product of some matrix by its transpose, so it's symmetric and it's even positive semidefinite. It's not only diagonal. First of all symmetric matrices are diagonalizable. They might have some equal eigenvalues. Maybe a few eigenvalues are the same, but you can always find orthogonal eigenvectors for every eigenvalue. There are extra degrees of freedom, but in particular you can find such a system that all your vectors will be orthogonal. But because it's X transpose, we also know that lambdas are non-negative. So it's a very well accepted problem. Okay. Any other question?
One question. How do I decompose my C into X times transpose X to get my Y?
No. Actually, I go in other direction. I start with my data. This usually what I have. What do I have in practice? I usually don't have distribution of X. What I have, collection of vectors. I mean, in this picture, collection of those points. I put every point as a column in matrix X. Then I multiply by X transpose and compute this empirically. Empirical covariance matrix C, and then go with eigenvalue decomposition. Okay. Yes. The question is how is related to networks. In the beginning of the lecture, let me see, control L. In the beginning of the lecture, you saw the following. In practice, you may use PCA or whitening for data preprocessing. So you have your data matrix X, and sometimes I don't say that it is a rule. If you want to transform your data in this form, to have your data cloud to be each component uncorrelated, this is exactly what you need to do. You see. But again, it was more recommendation for early networks. Today, in practice, people less use this, but because PCA is so important and so general procedure, I decided to dedicate few minutes.
Is the reason why we don't use it that much anymore because our decomposition takes more performance away from us than actually like have a more complex neural network model, or what's the reason behind
it? It's not easy question. It's more empirical observation. Sometimes if your data is not huge, you may do PCA numerically. You're asking that numerically it may be too expensive.
If your data has
huge dimension, yes, but not only this. It's okay. Like,
and why do I want to whiten my data? I mean, this means I add additional noise, right?
Whiten it, not make additional noise. This term is using in this context as you see, just to squeeze your cloud in to normalize. After you rotated the cloud, you just normalize every component, and then you get this plot. You don't add any noise.
Okay.
Whitening it means that your covariance matrix become identity. Mm-hmm. Yes.
In the previous slide, we will go back to the PCA.
Okay.
Our vector x is a vector of random variables, or is the vector of the samples?
We abuse a bit notation, so it depend on context. For example, this is vector of random variables.
How to?
Because you write expectation, usual expectation, you think it's vector of random variables. Here, I say, okay, now I will denote capital X as a matrix which every column has a data points.
It's the samples.
Yes, samples. That's why I say that covariance matrix is approximately equal to average.
So each column is a sample.
Yes, yes, yes.
Okay.
Each column is a vector of samples.
Vector sample, yeah. Vector sample, but it's like if I every second take a sample of my vector variable, so this index will be time in this direction. I don't have time. First second, second second.
But you have another dimension. I mean, it's not. No.
If you are. If you are thinking about that I have a million images, we are used to use neural networks for images, yes? So, every image is one long column in this matrix.
Okay.
So this is first image, I just put it into column.
So how do you define the Tochelet?
Expectation.
Oh, expectation of two images. What does it mean?
I can think pixels. About my. Here are pixels.
Similarity.
Here are pixels. So it's expectation of product. First of all, by the way, I have to subtract mean. I didn't write here full definition because it will be longer. So after I subtracted mean, the covariance is just expectation of product. Or if I want to compute it empirically, I take pixel number 1020 in coordinate 1020 of million of images, and I take two pixels from one image, I take two pixels in some definite positions.
In one picture.
In one picture. Compute, subtract mean, compute their product. Then in second picture, I do the same. And in 1 millionth picture, I do the same. For the same two positions. And compute average. And this get me approximately this number. Covariance between brightnesses of two pixels in some different positions. Okay, it takes time to get this. Okay. And
so the amount of the dimensions I have is the amount of data samples I have.
Dimension in X, which was 2 in our example, mm-hmm. It's number of pixels in your picture.
I think he asks about the dimension of the columns, and I think it's the number of samples you took.
I need to go
once
more to the...
I think you have like a column of samples for each variable you put in.
So, K is number of samples, is number of images. And N is number of pixels in one image.
So I get in every place, so C is a matrix that gives me the expectancy of each pixel in all of the pictures, in all of the samples combined.
Yeah. I have picture. And I choose a pixel at some position and pixel at some other position. So those will be two components of vector X. I subtract the mean of all pictures together. And then I compute brightness of this multiplied by brightness of this. For first image. Then I take second image and take two pixels in the same positions, and again compute this product. And then I average it among million images or billion images, and have this C, I don't know, 10,000. So this will be number 10 if I put image in very long column.
It's the correlation between the brightness of the two pixels.
Of two pixels, yes. Good. So it's important. It's very important to get to this stuff because PCA is so basic, you will find it everywhere. And by the way, what is the dimensionality reduction with use of PCA? You may have many such directions, and you will discover that all variants, for example, you may have 10-dimensional space, but all your variants, you may discover that axis of ellipsoid becomes shorter and shorter, and axis starting from number 4, 5, 6, until 10 are very small.
So PCA.
And I can substitute, I can forget about them and keep only three components.
For PCA is SVD? It's just a different thing?
No. Yes, in the way. Eigenvalue decomposition of X, X transport is exactly related to a singular value decomposition of X. So those are very intimately related things. You're right. Okay. Let's move back to neural networks. Okay, so. People do kind of pre-processing and different, you have in the lecture different recommendations. What reasonable thing you can do with pre-processing of the data. And then the next question, what is reasonable initialization of weights of your neural network? And the most primitive recommendation is just to initialize a small number, random numbers. But it's okay for small networks, but with network large, actually what will happen, you multiply layer by layer by W, and if it is small, you very soon will get to zero. So your all your data will be concentrated around origin. All outputs of neurons will be concentrated around origin. And that's why people use something different, so-called caviar initialization. And they say, okay, let let us initialize our weights assume we first of all normalized our data, that variance of every input is 1. And then the question is, what can I do with my weights? And I had the auxiliary slide for this topic. I have X outputs of my neurons of previous layer, and I want to sum them with some weights in the way that the variance of this sum will be 1. What is the reasonable thing way to do it? Let me remind very very basic stuff. If I have 2 independent random variables, so what is the variance of their sum? Just sum of variances. If I have a random variable and multiply it by scalar, what is variance of this product? It's just a squared multiplied by variance. If I have this expression, this is what I actually have here, yes? If I have y is inner product, assume for a moment that x is a random variable and a is just a constant vector. What is the variance of y? It's interesting that this is... And this is sum of, like we told here, ai squared by xi, sigma xi. But assume that sigma xi are the same. All of them are the same, or 1. So I substitute a with w. So you can take it out of sum and stay with sum of ai squared. Or 2 norm of ai squared. This is exactly what is written here. So sigma y. So in order to have, if this this is 1, in order to have this one, we need this norm to be squared norm to be 1. Or if w is random, interestingly, it's expected squared norm. Let's say it's random and it has 0 expectation, zero mean. And I will ask what will be expected squared norm. Sum of squares of components of w. Assume each w is independent. So it's just sum of squares of variances of every component. Okay. This one can check this himself. And this should be 1. So I get to very simple conclusion that sigma w should be 1 over square root of n. So if I have n inputs, I just generate w as zero mean, say Gaussian independent variables with this sigma, and in this way I have y also with unit variance. Yes.
אז למעשה האינטואיציה להתחול כסבר הזה זה כדי שלא נשנה את השונות של הסמפלים שלנו?
Yes, the intuition is not to change variance of samples when we go from layer to layer. Exactly.
לא קובע את הנאמר מישהו?
לא,
אולם חייב לעשות בש נורמליזיישן יותר יותר. זה רק ההתחול.
It's only initialization, בש נורמליזיישן will be later. It's kind of related, but it's different stuff. Okay, and this is what we had in the slide. You see, those are slides of Carpathia here. Oh, sorry. Don't walk in. He likes to express everything in, I don't know, in Python. So he has, you generate random variables, normally distributed, and divided by square root of number of inputs, yes? So this is exactly what we put. And one more thing, if we have ReLU activation function of this kind, non-linearity of neuron of this kind, which is zero for negative arguments, and say this is x and this is y, and the output is so real u. Then the variance of output will be twice smaller than variance of input, because for negative you get zero. And that's why they do some additional correction of factor of 2 at some point. You see the factor 2 in denominator, so you like increase your variance twice in order to edit it. Okay. Actually, today, like I sent you email, more material, and we will continue after break. We will have break in a few minutes, and then we will continue. If you wish, I would advise you to stay for the second hour. Let's continue a little bit more before the break. Okay. And now, very important topic, so-called batch normalization. So the idea is to force the variances of the outputs of every layer to be close to identity, even during training. And this was very successful proposition. And in 2015. Interestingly, first time when this was mentioned in the Stanford course, it was like presented 2 months before the lecture. It was presented in the lecture, and the batch normalization was presented in NIPS conference 2 months before the lecture. You may appreciate the level of intuition of Andrei Karpathy. He knew that this is worth to introduce into the course, only 2 months after it was invented. was the proposition? Just from output of every layer, subtract the empirical mean in current mini-batch. So you take mini-batch of the data, you compute mean in this mini-batch, subtract it, and divide by variance, empirical variance in this mini-batch. It's very important.
Why would you want the minimum of the mini-batch?
Not minimum. You do your training of your network portion by portion of data. It's mini-batch after mini-batch. Okay? For every portion of data, you think about your network as a whole, you want to compute your gradient of your function and go to gradient descent, do one step of gradient descent, and so on. And the proposition was in every mini batch, in every quantum of your training, every elementary step of your training, to estimate the variance of your output. How can you estimate the variance of your output? I have mini batch with, I don't know, 100 examples. So I the only thing I can do, I can subtract mean over those 100 examples empirical mean and divide it by the square root of empirical variance. Just a second. Let's go through and then do the session. And usually people enter the layers. So this operation is like layer of batch normalization. For example, and quite often it was used in fully connected layers. So you have fully connected layer, and then batch normalization, then nonlinearity, and so on, and then again batch normalization. And this procedure, what people do in every mini batch computer, empirical mini, and so on. And one more thing, after they did this normalization, they introduced another degree of freedom. I still can allow to multiply my data by some constant gamma and add some constant beta, which I start in my learning from gamma equal 1 and beta equal 0, and I let my optimization process to optimize it. So actually, I could even undo my batch normalization with certain values of gamma and beta. But actually, I don't do it. I choose initial gamma, for example, 1, and initial beta 0, don't undo anything. But they will gradually change with training to get some reasonable optimal values. Let's see what we have else. Let's stop in time at this point and ask questions, and then go to break. What was the question?
How do you choose the mini batch?
Okay, the size of mini batch is a rather empirical thing. We didn't touch yet stochastic gradient method. Maybe we will touch a little bit later. Stochastic gradient, poor stochastic gradient, do one step, one optimization step by every data point, but by every data sample. From computational point of view, it is more efficient to take group of samples than your processor, for example, will be used better. And quite often those mini batches may be, say, few tens or maybe hundred samples. Despite that, today, when people do to large parallel computation, they discover if you use really large mini batch to compute your gradient in many parallel computers and then sum together, then a mini batch of size of few thousands or even 10,000 or maybe 30,000 may become reasonable, and this is open line of research today to do good optimization methods which may work reasonably well with six or large mini batches. Okay.
If I use mini batches, how do I know that when I do different epochs that they don't undo what I learned? But one batch gets the gradient and the function to move in one direction, and the next batch will cancel that out and return to
previous
position.
This is question of stochastic gradient method. Stochastic gradient method works in this way, but so you do small steps in direction of gradients related to each sample. But if you average them, you will discover that actually your statistically go in direction of total gradient. This is more or less a very short, very brief answer. The full answer should be much deeper. Okay, let's do the break and then continue. So, was some question in terms of? It also competes with dropout. We will see dropout later. So Bechner normalization was introduced relatively recently, and it really, it first of all, it dramatically accelerates training. It's an empirical observation, and also makes generalization better. It's still not 100% clear. There are some words which try to explain this, but it's so strong method. It is like almost everywhere it's used. It's by default. Yes.
No, but you should try. I'm convinced that when you do the normalization, you set the temperature more in the area where the functions are operating, and that's good. But I don't understand how it's. איך זה קשור ליכולת הכללה, ואיך אתה אומר שזה כאילו, שזה קצת מוריד את הצורך לדרופ אאוט, אני לא מבין מה הקשר
Yes, the question was why is this improved generalization? It's empirical observation. Some partial explanation, you can allow large step sizes without being afraid that your weights will saturate, go out. Full explanation, it's out of scope of this lesson, but take it as empirical observation at this point, and maybe if I will find that you, or you will find some interesting works which give explanations, you can discuss them even in the class. And some technical note that after we train the network, pay attention to that every iteration we use the denominator for every mini batch. After we train network, we don't want to apply it to mini batch, we want to apply it to a new training example, to a new picture and know whether it's Apple or something else. So what should we do? The solution is very simple. You try to use this denominator values on the base on average of your data, which you may could collect during training or even compute independently on some other large portion of data. Okay. Okay. Another topic that was touched in the lecture that many parameters are rather the training process is sensitive to the choice of parameters. For example, learning rate is step size in your gradient, stochastic gradient direction. So these are very typical curves. So if you have too high learning rate, you may even diverge. Or if you have too low learning rate, you will converge well, but relatively slow in the beginning. And if you have high learning rate, not extremely high, but still too high, you will do good in the beginning, but start oscillate from some point. So and not only all learning rates, there are some other parameters like we will learn momentum and so on. And the question is what is a good way to tune parameters? If for example I have 20 parameters, yes, I may run many experiments and try to choose among those 20 what are optimal. But I have a grid of possible values in 20 dimensional space. It's too large to tune them, too many experiments. And what is proposed here in the lecture is not, instead of using a regular grid for example, I have to tune two parameters here, yes? Instead of using a regular grid for every coordinate, for every parameter, like say learning rate and momentum, which we will learn later, just choose random points. Choose random points with the hope that quite often parameters are not very strong interdependent. So if I want to tune one parameter which is here on the horizontal axis, with regular grid I actually will miss this point where it is optimal. And with irregular grid, with random sampling, in this coordinate I will get enough points really to hit this maximum. This is a kind of note on practice in tuning neural network. And this is the summary of this lecture. Activation functions quite often ReLU is used instead of classical hyperbolic sampling.
Why not leaky ReLU?
Also used,
but yes, it seems to me that
ReLU also used.
There should be.
I don't know. This is the work that it has advantages. On the other hand, in many empirical observations, people didn't see clear advantage. So,
but there's no disadvantage, isn't it? Or is there?
Does it have disadvantage? It's not easy question for me. I know that in practice by default people start with ReLU, but you can try other functions as well, and they maybe behave better out of scope of my practical experience. So so initialization, Bayesian normalization, and tuning learning process. Okay. And let's move fast to the second lecture. Training. Again, you have around 100 slides there, and I have much more, not much less, sorry. So they say, first of all, about stochastic optimization. So we during our course, we learned gradient and quasi-Newton, Newton, quasi-Newton, and so on. And they may be useful in neural networks. But when you have a huge training data, it quite often very practical to do is to do small steps on small portions of data. And then the approaches we used with line search or computing Hessian matrix become relatively problematic. So simple methods like gradient descent, so if you do it by single sample, stochastic gradient descent, or we may use it by portions of data, which are mini batches or batches in D different terminology. So they are rather practical and will accept it in neural networks. So, and here is again, like he likes to express everything in Python. So you compute your loss, you compute dx's gradient by back propagation, you compute gradient, and go in direction of minus gradient with some constant which is called logarithmic rate. And this is the basic method. And now he gets motivation which we already had also in our lectures, that gradient is too much zigzagging. But solution in stochastic optimization are a little bit different than we used to. So the solution is momentum. So to avoid zigzagging somehow, we want to stay with direction of previous step and change it only a little bit with new gradient. And exactly what is written here. Say V was the previous step, so we may have constant mu like 0.9, something like this, multiplied by previous step minus learning rate multiplied by gradient. So gradually, we only gradually will change direction and avoid zigzagging. This is the intuitive explanation. But in practice, momentum is very reasonable. And again, it's default in many settings. Instead of using stochastic gradient, use stochastic gradient with momentum. Some motivation using heavy ball. Another option which often has advantage. So if momentum I can express in this diagram, I compute gradient, but I go with momentum with my previous step. So I go with this green line, green arrow, and then go by red one, and this will give me actual new step. Another possibility is to go with momentum as long as I wanted to go, wait a second, and then compute gradient at this point. So my gradient is more relevant to where I want to be. And this is called Nesterov kind of update. And quite often it may give some advantage.
But the last step was already the momentum step, so I basically do two steps at the same direction.
You just continue with momentum a little bit more than you wanted to. Let's try to draw some picture. Just two steps.
Das ist jemand, der damit wollen die modern werden.
Yeah.
So,
are you following this camera? Is this okay? Is camera showing? White work is okay. Okay. But be careful with the screen because last time it was damaged. Okay. Say. I have the point x, k, minus 1. And here is xk. Mm-hmm. And now I want to think how to continue. So in usual gradient with momentum, I will compute here gradient and take this direction and combine this. In Nesterov approach, I will not stay at this point. I will continue a little bit more, as long as momentum wanted me to continue. And compute gradient, say, I can denote as xk tilde. and compute gradient here minus g. And goes somehow. And this will be my actual xk plus 1. Xk plus 1. But I will not go here. I will not compute here anything. I just put it as imaginary point. Because I have this line. And continue here. And like it was step, and this momentum I will continue here. And compute g minus g k plus 1. And so this kind of processing.
And, but with the, how does it deal with the back propagation? I mean, like, we have to change the whole algorithm to do this, right? Because we have the gradient in the point.
You compute everything at those points. You do back propagation at this point.
So we send like the momentum step forward,
yes,
and calculate the back propagation knowing the momentum step. Okay.
Yes, at this point you do back propagation. And that gives some advantage. It's still open question. People try to play with this. That's why I showed you those diagrams of tuning. Which method to use, it's also part of tuning.
In this picture, the momentum step is just a gradient of the last step, or is it something different?
Momentum step is combination. Momentum is difference between your point and previous point.
Yeah, so in this picture, the momentum step is the red arrow.
So what is green? Do I have green? Is there anything green? No. I will use blue instead of... What? I have to use black instead of green. Black, green, red. Okay. I should do it with the same colors to make it clear. So this is gradient, yes? This is gradient. Okay. So just a second.
You want the green then?
Ah, green. Oh, okay. No, I can green.
Does it work?
Let's see.
Now it's gone.
No. Okay. What happened?
You put the green one on the mouse button.
Okay. Okay. So this is this green. Yes? But and this blue, okay. And this is blue. We need to do more than one step to.
The blue one.
Who has good blue? Okay. No.
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
I have many teaching assistants here. Mm-hmm. Audience, I see. Okay. So this was actual step. And my momentum will continue it. And here I will compute gradient. And this will be blue. New blue. And this will be new green, yes?
Yes.
New green, and this again is red. Red, and this will be blue. Okay, now you can discuss it again. Okay. Is the picture more clear now?
Yeah. So the moment.
So you just need more than one iteration to understand it. Yes. Okay. Any comments? Any question? Okay. Good. And what? Here is a delicate point. Here they mentioned how to do it in numerically efficient way. And Adagrad. Adagrad is very important concept. And again, to understand it, I won't get back to this zigzagging slide. We have this zigzag Adagrad. That new window, and please try to verify that everything is okay on the screen. New window, and let's get to this zigzagging picture. Okay, so when our level lines are elongated, we don't know it yet, but pay attention. What happens here? The variation, the strength of gradient in this direction is much higher, and variation is also much higher. What people say, we are interested in to reduce this step in this direction and to increase in this direction. And this is exactly what Adagrad tries to do. So at every component. Okay, this is notion of Python. It's not notion of MATLAB. In MATLAB you would have dot here. The coordinates twice operation. So here you collect components. You collect components of gradient. So in every element of this vector, you have corresponding accumulation of corresponding squared partial derivative in this coordinate. So coordinates were squared, and then we divide by this factor with some regularization. So if partial derivative was on average high, we will dump it. And it was on average square was small because we divide by it. We will divide by small numbers, so we will increase. Mm-hmm. And this is a very simple idea, but actually it is very efficient. Adagrad or Adagrad with momentum become almost standard, at least in initial training. Afterwards you can try to tune, and it happens that usual stochastic gradient with momentum, with good tuning, may give you better results final stage.
Explain again so how Adagrad works.
So it divides every component. Your vector is just a second. Let me try to. If I have a vector of gradient, instead of, I take vector of gi, ith component of gradient, divide it by, do I take square root? I do take. Divided by square root of sum over t, sum over previous steps of gi squared. Maybe mathematically it's easier than in Python.
Okay.
So this is the formula and so I do it for every component. Independently, pay attention that independently, it's not norm of gradient. It's just expected square.
Okay, and why is it good?
And why it's good, I try to explain it to you by hand waving. Then in this picture, in this oscillating picture, you would say me that I am interested to reduce the steps in this direction to have less oscillation and increase my movement in this direction.
Oh, so if I had big step size towards this direction,
big gradients, not step size, the gradients.
Big gradient
in this direction I go down it on average. But what I see on history, I don't check whether it's big at this current point. Historically, it was big in this direction. Then I dump it. I reduce it.
I also noticed that in all of those algorithms, we use a constant learning rate.
It's not constant, it's less sensitive, because it also, this denominator, somehow, it also free parameter, it may be less sensitive, it's easier to choose it. If you are mistaking a few times, it's kind of a little bit self-correcting, because this denominator, if your learning rate
I don't use on your words.
Actually, you don't use. Okay.
It's constant.
The learning rate is constant.
You use it, but it's less sensitive. It's not my only comment on this.
Can I use changing learning rate, like in a
you
or something?
Usually, you have less. You have less need to have schedule of your reducer. Pay attention that this denominator becomes stronger and stronger towards that.
Oh.
In contrast to other variations when it doesn't happen.
But if I use...
For example, let me do a couple of slides more and then we will discuss again. Just only check that everything is good on screen. Okay, so there is very similar method which is called RMS probe. It different from undergrad. That here you has accumulation over all history in denominator, mm-hmm. And here in denominator you have like moving average. How they achieve this moving average? They have this current sum, but multiplied by say 0.9 or 0.999, and only add. This new squared derivative is 0.1 or 0.001. So it doesn't diminish as strictly as undergrad. So undergrad is proven to be a kind of optimal for convex stochastic program. But with new neural network, one should be more careful with reducing fast its learning rate. So. In this case, in this way, RMS probe is better, maybe better.
So if we use...
And just let me finish. And Adam, it's one more addition. It's like RMS probe with momentum. And M stays for momentum. And finally, many people as default use today this method. At a grad with momentum, or RMS probe with momentum. Yes.
Okay.
this. Now I have this.
If I have a very big network and I look at the history and every time I see I take a big step in a direction I already took in the gradient, I scale it down. What could happen is that halfway through the optimization, my step size would get very, very small, even though I'm not done burning.
And yes, yes. Exactly. You see, your question was actual before this slide. And yes. This slide gives you answer.
So if I get stuck...
So you get moving average. You divide not from the beginning, but like kind of you have some length of history. So you, if you get stuck, your denominator will slightly increase. Mm-hmm. Okay. But thank you for the question. Okay.
Can you explain again the Adam algorithm? So M is the momentum, I don't understand.
It's
like Adam with momentum.
Yes. It are like RMS probe with momentum. So this your denominator, yes? M is a combination of previous step. Pay attention that your direction of progress is M. And M is combination of previous M with new
direction,
new gradient. So you diminish components of M, not components of gradient, yes? It's like combination of two. One should look on it carefully.
So it shouldn't be M instead of DX though?
M is instead of DX.
No, in the update of V. Because I want to remember
you,
what
you, you have three things. So that's why you say I want my V is really oscillations of gradient, yes?
The gradient, yes.
Moving average of oscillations of gradient, okay. And I divide by it, but I divide momentum direction, which is already a combination of. So I did divide not pure gradient, but gradient combined with previous step.
But what
Whether it's reasonable, not reasonable, I don't know. One should study it more carefully. Okay. This slide you also was in the learning rate. You are very good in the beginning, so you want to start with high learning rate and maybe then reduce it somehow and here just different policies of decay. Which of them is better? For convex optimization, it is no optimal decay, even 1 over square root of t, but then you need to use average of your all axes, and this is Boris Polyak approach. This is old work, maybe 30, more than 30 years ago, which shows that actually your current x should be average. If you want to say what is your good x, you go with stochastic gradient, but then you average all those points which you passed in x, in weights, in your weights. And this is kind of optimal policy with 1 over square root of t. But for non-convex optimization, empirical, different policy, including adaptive policies of rate decay. Okay. And LBFGS we already learned. It may be recommended when you work with huge mini batches or even do one iteration over all data if your all data is not very huge and you need to get to very good accuracy. LBFGS may be worth to try. Like I told, in practice, Adam is quite often good first choice for stochastic optimization.
Can you go back a slide? What do they need with? Don't forget to disable all sources of noise.
I mean, do your data as clean as possible, then accurate optimization will have more sense, maybe.
Okay.
Maybe this is
That's something I would always do, I mean, no matter of the method.
But for stochastic gradient, maybe it's less critical, and even in paradoxical ways, sometimes a little bit noisy data is even better for learning. Okay, let's see how many. Okay, we don't have very much. One more tip. It's a good idea to train several similar neural networks. Like teach few experts and then use average opinion. And in practice, he says that extra 2% on average, 2% say in classification accuracy. But this gives you motivation. Also the same, you can average historical checkpoints of network. If you train network for a long time, it becomes a kind of a little bit oscillating. So you may use previous points and average between them. Use moving average, which is here in this row of the slide. And actually, what I told you about Boris Polyak approach is average between. In his work, he shows that for convex optimization, convex stochastic optimization, the strategy of averaging everything from the beginning of your training is a kind of optimal. But for neural networks, some compromise may work. You do moving average of your x, and it also may be rather useful. And one more important topic is dropout. Which was introduced by group of Hinton. You know, Hinton is founder of modern, not only modern neural network. He started actually in the beginning of I think in the 70s. And now all new wave of deep learning comes from his group actually. Many very known people are his former students, are members of his group. And on this new wave of return of neural network, drop out this trick he suggested, that it helped in, to get state-of-the-art results in many important cases. How important it is now, it is open question. Because now I saw the work with being very clever with initialization of network and so on, or with batch normalization, it's not clear whether dropout is unique, but still it's very important to be aware that it existed. It may be very helpful. So what does it say? That it says that during training of the network, I randomly multiply by zero outputs of random subset of neurons. And still I hope that my network will do it, will function well. In this way I do my training from kind of robust from the situation that there will be one neuron that makes all the work and the other neurons are out of work. It's one motivation. So and another motivation, another motivation, I at every step I have a subnetwork and I want this subnetwork to be a good expert to solve reasonably well my task. And what I will do in the end, like I will do stochastic average of those experts. Another hand waving explanation why dropout may be useful. Yes.
When am I doing this? Like, do I train it and then do the dropout and use it for testing, or do I do the dropouts, do some learning, and like?
So, you do dropout, random dropout at every stochastic gradient step, different dropout.
So during
every
learning,
mini batch, I do different. I choose randomly configuration of my network at every mini batch. This is during training. During test, I do very simple thing. Because during training, I use on average, for example, half of neurons, and during test I will use all the neurons, then I may divide output by two. Or the same, divide all the weights by factor two. To have it on average to do the same work.
Basically,
but I will take complete network. I will don't do any randomization at test time.
Basically, I damage the network before I use it. Why would I want? I don't manage to understand.
I think the
idea is that I want. I have a large network, and I want random subnetworks of my network to do the job. And this will be an expert, one expert. The subnetwork is one expert. And then I say, okay, I have many such experts, I will use the average.
But when I use the full network, then the expert will get mixed with random other people, I don't know, that are not experts.
No, all they are experts, because it's randomly switched very often.
And what is
every step is randomly switched.
But if we use the full network, then everybody is an expert all the time.
The full network, it will adapt better and faster to my training data. And because of this pruning, I kind of, by some miracle, increase my generalization ability. So my training become more slow, it's more difficult to adapt to training data. This is what usually people see with dropout. but generalization become better. It you might think in parallel, people use so-called weight decay during training. So they may put a penalty of sum of squares of all weights in the network. It makes the training more difficult. I penalize myself. I should move stronger, yes, to do the same. But it makes generalization better. Here you damage yourself in some different way.
In this case, for example, in the second level node, if the first layer have some nodes that have found a feature, so the second layer can trust about one node. And if you are using dropout, you cannot trust one specific node. You need to be more robust.
It basically prevents overfitting.
Yes. Yes, you must say this.
Okay.
Simulate and assemble.
I think it's similar to use two networks and compare it at the end.
Use a lot of networks and compare them at the end.
Yeah. So basically it should give you just 2% performance increase.
In 2% performance increase can be significant sometimes.
So this at least what Andrei Karpaty brings you as explanation, following of course the work on Hinton. It's very good to read an original paper of Jeff Hinton and his collaborators. He's very good writing. And you understand much more than is discussed in usual lectures. In the paper you really find
from whom?
A lot of clever thoughts of a person who works more than 30 years, maybe 40 years in this area. And only to train his network, rather than. Let's see. Are we running out of time? Okay, sorry. So it's an unusually long lecture today. Okay. So there are more technicalities on it. Okay, thank you very much. If you have any questions or again,